Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Triangulation, episode 144, recorded March 24th, 2014. Steve Gibson. Triangulation is brought to you by Personal Capital. With Personal Capital, you'll finally have all of your financial life in one place and get a clear view of everything you own. Best of all, it's free. To sign up, go to personalcapital.com/triangulation. And by Prosper. Prosper is a peer-to-peer lending marketplace that connects people who are looking to borrow money with those who have money to lend. Visit prosper.com/twit to receive a $50 Amazon gift card when you get a loan. And by Nature Box, where you can order great-tasting, healthy snacks delivered right to your door. Forget the vending machine and get in shape with healthy, delicious treats like citrus chipotle chickpeas. To get 50% off your first box, go to naturebox.com/twit. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get together with some of the most interesting, smartest people in the world and have a little conversation. It's my chance, really, to sit down for an hour with people that I'm dying to talk to. Originally scheduled on this show, perhaps you saw it, perhaps you're tuning in for it, Dr. Michio Kaku, one of the great physicists and experts on string theory. Dr. Kaku had to reschedule. We were hoping for next week or the week after. So stay tuned for that. But we're very pleased to get somebody on that probably, if I count all the votes, all the requests, is the most requested guest on Triangulation. And somebody, anybody who watches our network knows well, he was the host of the very second podcast on the Twit Network, Security Now. He's a well-known security guru. Mr. Steve Gibson joins us. And people, hey, Steve, welcome.
I know nothing about string theory, Leo. So we'll both be tuning in to learn from your next guest.
Anybody who says they do is lying, except maybe Michio Kaku. The reason that people want to know more about Steve is because even though we've seen him now for hundreds of episodes on Security Now every week on this network, we only talk about a few narrow topics. Security, certainly, but a little bit on science fiction, TV shows, diet. But there's a whole world of stuff we don't know about Steve Gibson.
Well, so, and also to the degree that we do go further off the reservation, it's before we begin recording typically. And so it never actually ends up in a podcast. It's, you know, on the cutting room floor or only seen by those people who are able to watch live. So
now one thing we do know about Steve, he can cut a rug. And he can, do we have the video? He came up for...
we've been looking for it.
It's on my desktop.
Oh, thank God it's lost.
It's all right. I'll show it another time. We'll save it for you. He came up for our New Year's Eve party, which was great fun. I know you'll be back again. And danced with Captain Kirk at midnight. It was a cutout of Captain Kirk, but that's no matter.
Yeah, he really didn't help at all.
You had to lead.
I had to lead and follow and pretty much handle the whole deal. But
we did get to see.
It was a festive time, and I stood there looking at that cutout, thinking, "Should I or shouldn't I?"
I gotta dance with that.
And there's, you know, alcohol is no excuse because I was pretty much sober.
In fact, if anything, he was high on coffee. Earlier that day, we had made coffee together. That was one of the segments you did.
Yeah, I wouldn't have been able to stay on my feet, I think, if I'd had very much to drink with all of the spinning that we were both doing together, the captain and I.
Fantastic coffee you made for us.
Tiberius.
James Tiberius Gibson, I call him. So, Steve, I guess, as usual, with Triangulation, I'd like to start with the early days and how you became a geek. Were you a geek as a kid?
Yeah, I was. One of my earliest memories is when the family would get together, the extended family, for Christmas. And my grandparents were prolific, so I had lots of aunts and uncles who didn't know me well because I pretty much only saw them for Christmas. But they did know that they had to come up with some sort of a present. And so I used to hear the stories about how they would go into the local toy store store back, you know, when we had local toy stores before the internet, and they'd go to the manager and say, okay, look, I have this nephew that's a real pain in the ass, and I need the hardest puzzle you have.
Like puzzle pieces, like jigsaw puzzle?
Oh, whatever it was. Like one year it was Instant Insanity. Remember the four cubes that were where in the package you saw all red, all white, all green, and all blue. But the moment you broke it up and scrambled them, then the challenge was to rearrange them that way again. I mean, so whatever it was, essentially for me, Christmas was opening up a raft of puzzles. Sometimes they were, you know, the convoluted hard wire things like nails bent that you had to, you know, move around and manipulate them to slip them out. Anyway, I do love puzzles. And so that was one of the, you know, I guess I always have had that penchant and sort of been like that. So yeah, they used to tell me that, and they would always think, okay, now we got you. You little you're not going to be able to figure this one out.
And would you have solved them all by the end of Christmas Day?
Yeah, right then on the spot.
Right there. Oh, yeah, that's easy. You know. It sounds like it became a thing. Like, oh, let's see what we can get this year.
Well, I mean, like, one year was Towers of Hanoi.
Oh, yeah, that was fun.
You know, the physical thing.
Did a lot
and
of
so,
that.
And so I would do it once, and then they'd say, okay, no, wait, you cheated. And I go, okay, sit down, Aunt Mary. I'll show you. And so I'd start moving the little donuts from one peg to the other.
It was the three pegs, and you had this. Now, what's interesting, and I also had that as a kid.
Recursion. It's classic recursion.
Well, that's what's interesting. It's one of the early computer programs you will write, and it's a great challenge for kids learning computer programming because it's a lot of steps if you don't know about recursion. But as soon as you figure out recursion, it's can be solved in just a few lines. It's really a simple problem.
Yep. And then there was NIM. Remember NIM, where you have some number of like matches and you can either take one, two, or three, I think it is, and you alternate and try to get the other person to get stuck with the last match. And anyway, I delight in that kind of thing. So yeah, I think pretty well. And of course, the classic, the portable dog killer story, that was me in high school. And so, but there was, of course, there was a long preamble to that that led up to the point where I was just able to decide I needed to build one of those to deal with the neighborhood dog. So,
well, yeah, that's what I'm curious about. When it went from physical puzzles to something more electronic, did you start with like Heath kits and that kind of thing?
You know what it was? Well, first of all, I was very destructive to the household. Mom would, you know, go into the closet to get the vacuum cleaner and come out with the hose, and the rest had been disassembled because Stevie needed to know
how it worked. How do it suck? Yeah.
And so, she'll tell the story, which generally happens on my birthday, although that hasn't been for some number of birthdays, about the rah-rah. I was fascinated with the record player, just watching it go around. Just mechanics really fascinated me. And what my dad finally started doing was, at that time we were living in Orinda, which is on the other side of the Berkeley Hills, sort of in the like way out in the suburbs of Northern California. Of course, you know where it is.
Yeah.
Marinda, Moraga area.
Yeah, beautiful area.
And we would, on a Saturday morning, Dad and I would drive over to the docks in Alameda, and naturally there was sort of and that was a big shipyard, and it was encrusted with war surplus stores, and we'd go into these and Dad would find some big thing, some big like a radar unit that had been, you know, pulled out of a ship, and I remember that you bought this by weight. They had a huge scale with a big fish hook on the end.
They basically thought it was scrap metal. They didn't.
Yeah, and so they'd hang it, and it would, you know, the dial would spin around, and Dad would pay the guy $7 for, you know, this 15 or 20 pound thing. And so then we would bring it back home, and Dad would leave the cars out of the garage, put it in the middle of the garage on the concrete with his toolbox next to it, and say, okay, Stevie, take it apart. And there is nothing I wanted more to do than to peer inside this and disassemble it. Now, this, of course, saved the iron and the vacuum cleaner and the dishwasher and the, you know, what would otherwise be my objects of disassembly. This, you know, satisfied me. And
how old were you? How old were you at that point?
Okay, so I was, I was in a different house after that when I was in the fifth grade. So I was like five. In fact, my dad took a picture of me that I have on my resume, grc.com/resume.htm, which is me at age four. And you can see me there sitting at, this is the same house on Overhill in Orinda, sitting at a picnic table, wiring stuff. There was a dry cell battery and the little ceramic base screw, you know, light screw and knife switches. And I wanted to know about electricity and how it worked and why you had to complete the circuit, why you couldn't just have the wire go to the battery and the light and then it would light up. But no, you had to, so I was, you know, really demanding to understand this. I don't know why, but that's just, it was in me. And years later, Dad said that this was all very deliberate on his part. He was, you know, sort of taking credit for this. And he said, Steve, I knew that when we were putting this war surplus equipment in the center of the garage and you were tearing into it, you were looking at it. He said, I watched you. You were studying it. You were wondering why the gears were split with a spring in order to eliminate the backlash in the gear chain on the tuning knob. And he said, you were deeply internalizing the country's supreme engineering, the best engineering that the country had. You were studying it. And he said, I knew that someday, years later, you would, having internalized that, you would start being creative with all of that. And, you know, it is sort of the way things turned out. I'm not sure that it was causal like that, but I mean, I've always had this passion.
There's a great picture of you on your website of you at the age of four. Looks like you're building a doorbell or something. I'm not sure exactly what it is you're
making. Well, it was just wiring. I wanted to understand, like, you know, make the light up when I close the circuit with a knife switch and so forth.
Some people's brains are just wired in such a way that this is a thing that innately appeals to them. I mean, it's obvious. Nobody had it. Was Dad an engineer? What did he do?
Dad had a degree in mechanical engineering from Berkeley. Mom also went to Berkeley. I remember, I mean, anything I could ask him, I would say, you know, how does this work? And first he would say, rip quite well. And I'd say, okay.
Dad was a little bit of a jokester.
yeah. But I mean, he could explain how on a camper you could use gas, which made heat, to make the refrigerator cold. I mean, you know, he understood all of that mechanical engineering, physics stuff. And so I got answers to my questions when I was patient.
Yeah. After he joked around a little bit.
Yeah. There was definitely some nurturing there. I mean, I was demanding it.
Yeah.
It wasn't being forced on me, but you know, anything I could ask, I could get an answer
to. That's nice.
Yeah, it was.
Had you been ignored, it might have been eventually you gave up and said, oh, I'm going to be a psychologist or something. I don't know. So did he get you the first computer? When did you get the first computer?
Wow. There were plastic computers. I remember one. There was this amazing thing. I don't remember the name of it now, but it had plastic slides and vertical bars. And you could slide plastic tubes. It was somehow kind of programmable. And I mean, so there were things.
Huh?
Yeah, there were, and you sort of move this slider back and forth, and it would move this thing through states, and you could make counters and shift registers and all kinds of amazing stuff. And again, I just, everything like that I could find. And it's like It's like how with that iPad puzzle Rails, I never got off the first level because
he keeps playing it over and over to get perfect.
I wanted to master it. Exactly. I wanted to know that anything it could throw at me, I could come up with a track system that would solve it.
Oh, see, that's interesting. I have the exact opposite point of view. If I don't like the starting point, I'll do. Give me a new starting point.
Ah.
I say, I can't solve that. That's too complex. That's going to be weird. I'm going to have problems with that. So you just keep obsessively doing it until you can figure everything possible out.
And in fact, just yesterday, I wrote the most beautiful binary search I have ever written. I've been coding for 45 years, and I posted a link in my feed to a PNG image of this binary search so that everyone could see it.
But wait a minute, hasn't that problem been solved many times in computer science?
And see, that's a key to my personality, which drives everyone crazy, except me. I think it's probably safe to say.
We don't need another binary search. We already know how to do that.
Yes, and in my I don't think it was in the post in the tweet that I sent because that was too short. But I also posted it to three GRC news groups just because I was so proud of it. It is the most gorgeous, elegant, perfect expression of a binary search I have ever produced.
Interesting.
And that just still, to this day, it just thrills me with joy. The fact that, and see, the typical binary search is one where you have a top and a bottom, and you jump into the middle, and then you have sorted numbers. You jump in the middle and see whether that is bigger or smaller than your target. And then you jump half that distance in the direction where it might be, and then you keep having your jump until you land on it. There's a different approach where instead you jump in the middle, and depending upon whether you're above or below, you move the clips, you move the top or the bottom in one past where you were. And technically, that stores a little more context in the things that are variable, and that's what gives you a tiny leg up on the bouncing probe approach. And I mean, again, that's what I live for. It's not that everybody else has already solved it. It's that I just wrote the most perfect expression of it for this particular application. This is all for the international version of Squirrel. And I'm going to have a list of pointers to strings in different languages. And I don't want to require that the list be uniformly increasing one through whatever, like 200, because then it's really difficult to maintain. I might want to insert one somewhere, but that would require renumbering everything, which would be a big nightmare. So I need it to be a sparse list. And if it's going to be sparse, it's easy to still have it sorted. But if it's sparse and I want to get a particular number, then the right way to do that is a binary search. And so I wrote one just for that. It is perfect for that.
Most geeks would go and say, well, let me see what the library has, you know, what the programming library for this language has available as a binary search, and just that.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's gets to the heart of it, because and this is when I explain myself to someone, I do so by saying,
Hello?
Something just happened. Oh, I think my...
Squirrel. We're talking to... Actually, go ahead and figure that out. We're going to take a break. But Steve Gibson is our guest. He's the host of Security Now, the author of SpinRite, which has been his bread and butter for more than a decade now. He is also, as you can see, a true enthusiast, and that's what we love about Steve. We'll have more. And I have to say, I know Steve a little too well to ask him the tough questions. So you, chat room, you ask those questions, and I'll make sure to pass them along, and then I can avoid any responsibility for what I'm saying. Our show today brought to you by Personal Capital. Personal Capital, with that, you know, we were talking, I think, earlier today about how do I make sure I have enough money to retire on so I can enjoy retirement. And I got to tell you, however young you are, it's always a good time to start thinking about your financial status, how you're doing, what you're doing, and making sure that you are doing the best for yourself, not for yourself today, but for yourself many years hence, retirement. I want to show you a free, secure tool. It's called Personal Capital. It solves two big barriers to keeping track of and increasing your wealth. One is, well, it's just hard to keep track of. You've got stocks, you've got bonds, you've got your 401k, you've got checking accounts, charge accounts, mortgages, loans, and each of them is a different web page, each of them a different login. It's very hard to see it all at once to get any sense of overall how you're doing. The second is if you are, investing, you may be paying too much for somebody to manage it. You may be paying too much in fees. You want to cut those costs down. Personal Capital solves both these problems. First, by bringing all your assets into one single page. And I want to emphasize, absolutely safe. You're not giving, you know, they use the same back end that banks and lenders and all these other sites are using to keep track of it. So you don't have to worry that you're giving them credentials that this is being stored in the same way, at the same place in most cases that your credentials are stored by your financial institution. So it's safe to do this, but what you get as a benefit is these incredible charts, real-time displays like a dashboard of your financial life on your computer, on your phone, on your tablet. Easy to understand. You can see immediately if you're overpaying in fees, how to reduce those fees. You'll get tailored advice on optimizing your investments. So don't wait. I don't care if you're 20 years old. I tell my kids this. Now is the time to start planning for the future. Signing up just takes a minute. It'll pay big dividends, and it is free. Personal Capital gives you total clarity and transparency so you can make better investment decisions today. PersonalCapital.com/triangulation to try it free today. This all started because 2 years ago we had Bill Harris, the founder, on the show, and we were talking. He was former CEO of Intuit, where you, of course, learned a lot about this kind of thing, of PayPal. Real expert in finances, and he had just started this, and I signed up, and I'm so glad I did. PersonalCapital.com/triangulation. Our guest today on Triangulation is Steve Gibson. You never did answer that question. Your first computer, was it a Commodore? Was it an Atari? What did you first?
Oh, no. My first exposure was I was a sophomore in high school, and the head of the math department said to me, Steve, there's some company in San Carlos. I was in San Mateo. So San Carlos was a couple towns south of where I was that has computers. And the name of the company was called Technica Education Corporation, TECNICA. And it was like, what? Now this is, you know, Gates and I are about the same age. So Bill's high school famously had a computer. My high school didn't have a computer.
That's right. But the moms got together. They had a bake sale, and they bought time on a timeshare. So really what they had, and I had this too in my high school, was a little tiny closet with a teletype in it. The difference is Bill went in there and played with it. I just said, that's stupid.
Well, and what happened was I made my mom drive me down.
No kidding.
To San Carlos.
Wow.
And I walked into this place and just sort of presented myself. And I said, hi there, I'm here. And they said, yeah, so?
You're 13 years old.
I was 13 years old.
Hi there, I'm here.
And yes. And actually, my hormones were very delayed in showing
hi
up.
Hi there,
so,
I'm here.
You know, yeah. There was no hair, and there was no pitch other than hi. And so I wandered into this, like the back, and there was an HP 2114 mini computer and the first PDP-8 I had ever laid eyes on.
A PDP-8.
And some guy named, Lynn something, L-Y-N-N. I can't remember his last name. He's last I knew, he was at VMware as Lynn Cooley. Lynn,
he's still around.
C-O-O-L-E-Y. Lynn Cooley, I think. And long hair, hippie kind of guy. And he knew assembly language. And I was soon to learn. So he took you
under his wing. He said, all right, you're 13. You're just a kid, but I'm going to teach you this.
Yeah. And I remember that they also had a Nova, I think.
A Data General Nova,
because I remember that there was an option that you could purchase, power fail auto restart. And I looked at and the Nova had large 16x16 inch PC boards. It was very few large PC boards. It was sort of, you know, we were still as an industry learning how to like make these, and we weren't making five and thinking that was good news. We were now making 50,000. So, you know, that we were beginning to scale, and that changes all of the calculations from a manufacturing standpoint. Anyway, the point is that Data General charged like $400 for the power fail auto restart option for the Data General Nova. And inspecting the circuit board, it seemed to me that the only difference was that there was like one chip and a couple resistors and a capacitor that were missing from the processor board that did not have this $400 option, and the one that did have the $400 option. So I went up, I was beginning to get to know the management of this place, and I said, a guy named Bob Senz, S-E-N-Z, who was the president at the time, he later was at Ace Hardware over in Half Moon Bay. I ran into him.
Working in a hardware store?
I think he was the manager of the hardware store.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, years later. Neat guy.
Not everybody became filthy rich in the computer industry in the early days.
And he took a liking to me because I was a nice kid was just obviously with this burning desire to touch this stuff, to learn. And I asked him if I could try upgrading the Novas that didn't have this option to, like, it saved them $400. And sure enough, I added that chip. Basically, I copied the one that did have it, and now we were no longer having to pay Data General $400 for, you know, a 13-cent chip and a couple random components.
And by the way, this whole story comes around full circle, because behind you, over your left shoulder, you have three simulators. They're recreations of the PDP-8, that first computer that you played with.
And I have a strong streak of nostalgia in me, too. I mean, when I look at those, I just think, oh, God.
Elegant, so simple.
Yes, and there was craftsmanship there. I mean, there was a strong influence in my life was my mother's father, so my grandfather on my mom's side, because my parents divorced around when I was in the fifth grade. And so that mom could have a life, I ended up spending a lot of time with her folks, with my grandparents. They were sort of, you know, babysitters for my sister and me. And my grandfather was a true world-class woodworker craftsman with bandsaws and sanders and lathes and all of that stuff. And he was really old school. And I mean, I can't count the number of times he said, a penny saved is a penny earned. Any job worth doing is worth doing well. He also, unfortunately, said, I opened the window in influenza. So you know, take the good with the bad.
Measure twice, cut once. There's another good one.
Oh, and he would tell stories about how when I was six, I would, and not really old enough to like be wiring anything with AC, I would be instructing him what to do, building these things. And he was like, are you sure? How do you know what this is going to do? I said, just, you know, I called him Daddy Don, because his name was Don Lawton. And I said, just, you know, put this wire over here and screw that down. And so he would do it. And sure enough, these things would light up or spin or whatever it was that they were supposed to do. But what I was going to say when we took the break was the thing that drives everyone crazy about me, except myself, is I am I am about the journey. I like the binary search. Yes, it's been done, but this one is the best one I've ever written. And I do it because I get to have this experience. It's like solving the puzzle at Christmas. I love how things fit together. I love to see how systems work. And, you know, it's the fascination I have with internet security where I'll plow into a protocol, figure it out, and then I love presenting it to our audience. So for me, when I finish something, I always go through sort of a postpartum phase where it's like, oh, you know,
You don't want to finish.
Yeah. I fully recognize that until I'm done, I've produced nothing of value.
Right.
And certainly, and the proof is in the pudding, which was another one of Daddy Don's. But still, I mean, so I do have to create something. But for me, the joy is in doing it. Hmm. And my experience also has reinforced this. That is, the things that I have created, that I have taken the time to do as perfectly as I can, first of all, almost always I discover things I didn't know. And this sort of ties into that story, The Portable Dog Killer, where, you know, the story of unexpected consequences. You know, if you don't do anything, there's no chance that you're going to discover something. And so for me, I trust that I can come up with a solution to whatever it is that I tackle. And another example was that longest repeated strings problem that I tackled about a year and a half ago, where I ended up coming up with essentially a breakthrough, as far as we know, an algorithm that computer science doesn't know for finding the longest repeating string in a huge corpus. Is just beautiful. And I just wanted to solve the problem when I began, and I iterated many solutions, learning something each time, but saying, you know, having finished this one, that taught me something, or watching it work, I would see some behavior that would give me a clue to how I could make it better. So I would scrap it because I don't have a boss, which is another thing that upsets people, because there's no one making me finish anything. But I have the privilege to start over and make it better. And it took about three or four times, and we wound up with something. Oh my God. I mean, it's just this incredible solution to that problem. So, you know, that's why I do these things, because you just never know what gems of experience lie in the process of getting the work done. And what comes out the other end is typically something really worthwhile. You know, Shields Up, I wrote once.
Right.
And I did come back to it, but it's just sat there and delivered value ever since. SpinRite 6, famously, 10 years old, yet still selling well and solving problems. The industry has moved under it so that I need to catch it up, which is what I'm going to do as soon as I finish Squirrel. But in general, you know, these things that I do, I take the time to absolutely get them right. And then I'm bored with them. I mean, then it's like, I never want to go back. I never want to look at it again. It's like, solve that problem. But I don't quit until I really have.
Sounds like you wouldn't do well with a boss.
No, I'm unemployable. Oh, my God.
We're talking to Steve Gibson. I am going to tell you something that I don't think anybody knows about Steve Gibson when we come back. All right. Steve Gibson is our guest on Triangulation, the creator of SpinRite. GRC.com is his website, and his Twitter handle is @SGGRC. Our show today brought to you by our friends at Prosper. Prosper is a Silicon Valley answer to the big bank, where you put on a suit and tie and you go and you say, please, sir, could I have a loan? Prosper is peer-to-peer lending, putting people who have money to lend, together with people who need some money. Imagine what you would do if you could have $35,000 in your pocket within the next 72 hours. Would you pay off your credit card debts? I bet you would. Those high-interest credit card rates, you don't need those. Start a business, maybe? if you're like Steve, you don't do well with bosses, best thing to do, create your own, right? Be your own boss. Maybe do that home improvement project you've been putting off. All you have to do is go to prosper.com/twit, fill out an easy online application, provide a few details, as you see here, and you'll get that rate almost instantly. And by the way, this will not affect your credit rating. So you can fill out that easy application, get that low rate. They're low fixed rates, unsecured personal loans. You don't need collateral, multi-year terms available. Prosper. More than 2 million members now, lenders and borrowers. Over 900 million in funded loans. Almost $1 billion. Go to prosper.com/twit. Check your rate right away. And for a limited time, Prosper is offering Twit viewers a $50 Amazon gift card when you get that loan. Go to prosper.com/twit. Up to $35,000 in just 3 days. Get that $50 Amazon gift card when you get the loan. Prosper.com, not affiliated with Amazon. For card details, visit prosper.com/twit. And we thank Prosper for their support for Triangulation. When Steve Gibson was 23 years old, this is something I never knew. He founded an ad agency. What?
Gibson and Garnish.
What? Why, Steve? You don't. This is the last thing I'd expect from you. I could see a computer consultancy, a technology. You worked for a Stanford Research Institute when you were a teenager. This I understand. Ad agency?
What happened was, I learned in my first job after college, a small startup called Mini Computer Technology. We were making, not coincidentally, disk controller boards for Novas and PDPs and Interdata. We were making them for mini computers. And it's probably that job which taught me to, I lost all of my fear or mystery of how hard drives worked. And these were the huge, the disk packs that are, the large multi-platter packs that you drop into something the size of a washing machine and then spin the cover to lock it in place and then remove the cover, close the lid, and then it spins up to speed and then the heads come out. And I think it's my background in that which ultimately led me to solve an ex-girlfriend's problem with her hard drive, which is what led me into SpinRite years later.
Your life is such a random walk. This is what I love. And you're happy. You love that.
What I learned at that company was I could both understand the engineering and communicate it. And that's an unusual thing for like an Uber geek,
yeah,
to also be able to speak English. And so since we were initially three of us, and I just sort of said, I'm going to talk to customers. And so I did the sales and marketing during the day and then worked with one of the super bright engineers in the evening on writing the software, the formatter and diagnostic and so forth for these things, and working on the engineering and also doing what we call bringing the controller up, which meant we would get a brand new board out of manufacturing, but it wouldn't work. So we have to, somewhere there was a tiny little wisp of trace that hadn't been fully etched away, creating a short circuit between two adjacent traces, and we'd have to locate that. So my point is that I learned that I could communicate technical things and that was useful. And so I ended up leaving Mini Computer, coming down to Southern California, being hired to do technical marketing for a company down here, Electronic Data, Educational Data Systems, EDS, not Ross Perot's
EDS.
Yeah, right. Educational Data Systems. I stayed there for exactly 1 year because I hated it. I was miserable, but
because you had a boss.
I had a boss, and it did not go well. And so when I quit, I decided what the world needed was high tech marketing, and so Gibson and Garnish was an ad agency that understood the products it was handling.
Was there a Garnish?
No, as in little stuff on the side.
No, but there There wasn't a person named Garnish.
No, no, it was Gibson and Garnish on the side.
It's the greatest name ever.
Isn't that great? Yeah.
And there is no Garnish. Mm-mm. So it was you. But you
it
had
me.
You had 13 accounts.
Yes. And what I learned was because I never slept. I never put more miles on my car. I mean, this was before typesetting.
Right.
So I would design the ad, proof it, show the client. They would sign off on it. Then I'd have to go to a typesetter where they use, you know, and typeset it, which gave you a long strip of camera-ready type.
Right.
Which I would then, with a razor blade.
Oh, I remember this.
I would wax the board, mm-hmm. and then using an X-Acto knife, cut the pieces of type apart and lay them out. And it was fun for the first 2 weeks or so. But, you know, then it got to be a real drag. And there was never any time to sleep because I'd be making presentations during the day and then having to do the work that I had overcommitted to
right.
at night. So what I learned was, yes, I was right. I mean, I could walk into a company. I walked into, I think it was Curonix that was a clone maker. They made Nova clones, and they were selling an asynchronous communication device. You know, this is back in the days where there was no internet, of course, so there was magazines. And so I was familiar with their ads, and their ads were awful.
Yeah.
Because a high-end agency with a great photographer took a picture
yeah.
that didn't mean anything to the engineers
right.
who were actually reading the ads.
Right.
And so I would go in and say, I'd meet the marketing guy, and I would say, what's special about your system is that you've got hardware ring buffers on your communications platform.
He had no
platform.
Idea.
And the Nova has a particular problem with its interrupt service overhead. So the competition's communications controller can't handle the bot. And the guy would say, wait, I'm the marketing guy.
I don't know this
stuff.
You
went engineering down the hall. I go, no, I'm your new ad agency.
That's exactly right.
He'd say,
right.
He'd look at me with a blank stare, and then he would say, yes, you are.
You're hired,
so,
kid.
The problem was I found out that, yes, the world did need high-tech marketing. Unfortunately, I didn't need the world to need high-tech marketing. I mean, I I never grew beyond me because I didn't want to hire anybody because I could tell in my soul that this was the wrong direction for
yeah.
me. So I did consulting. The Apple II came out, and that's when I developed the high-res light pen for the Apple II. That was I was Gibson Laboratories, the first company I founded by myself and designed and developed and grew. And
what
ended
is,
up selling.
You know, we know. I think most people know that you did this, or I've known this for years. What the hell is a light pen? This is not a peripheral widely used anymore.
It's a very cool thing. It is. It was the precursor to the mouse. So the reason I abandoned it was it was clear to me that the mouse was the right answer. But before we had the concept of the mouse. A CRT tube produces its image by scanning the beam across,
right.
and then like the very top line left to right, then it that quickly drops down, jumps back to the left, and scans it again. Well, if you hold a light sensor at the screen, which is extremely fast in its response. It can tell when the beam goes by.
Mm.
So if you think about it, if you were to count the number of lines that have occurred until the beam goes by, that gives you the vertical position of the light sensor. And if you time from when the beam was at the left, how long it takes to pass by the light sensor, that gives you the horizontal coordinate. And so... So it's possible if you have the ability to detect that instant of the beam passing, you can tell where you're holding this. Now, it turns out it was a hardware engineering challenge.
I bet.
Because most people want to use a phototransistor. because a phototransistor puts out a strong signal. The problem is a phototransistor has horribly slow response time. So that, I mean, all, in fact, there were some cheesy light pens where you would put them on the screen and hit the space bar, and then it would, and then you would actually do a binary search on the screen looking for where this thing was positioned, because all it could tell you was I'm seeing light or I'm not.
Oh, dear.
Couldn't tell you where it was. So I designed the hardware for the world's only high-resolution light pen for the Apple II. And I'd also learned the lesson really from Mini Computer Tech, because we had the hardware, but we also had to back it up with software. We had to provide a diagnostic and a formatter and drivers for the OS. And so I realized that if I just put the hardware out there, it wouldn't do anything. That I had to solve the whole problem. So then I extended the basic language. What Apple had kindly left some hooks in AppleSoft Basic that allowed you to extend it. And so I programmed again in assembly language in 6502 assembler. I created an extension to Basic that created a complete vocabulary that allowed anybody then to easily write software to use the light pen. And actually it was during this phase that I met Waz, and there was a memorable moment at one of the what was the Apple?
It was like Apple Fest.
Apple Fest. Yeah, it was Boston Apple Fest.
Yeah.
I was there with a 20 by 10 booth demonstrating the light pen, and there was a, and I always put, you know, some fun extra stuff in things. In this case,
Easter egg kind of
sort of. In this case, there was the Apple II had had different video modes, where you could show a text screen or a graphic screen or different things. Well, what I realized was if the moment the pen saw something, I switched modes, then I could create the world's first dual mode screen where that was controlled by the pen. So what the idea was, you could put the pen over in the far right edge, the far right column, and lift the pen up, and it would lift the graphics page up and show you a text page underneath it. We called it the skirt lifter, and
not because it in any way helped you meet women.
No, Mm-mm. No. Believe me, none of this was conducive. At no point was any of this conducive to meeting women.
But Waz knew what you were talking about.
Waz was stunned.
Yeah.
And he said, "Steve, your stuff never fails to amaze me."
Oh, so man, nice.
That really meant a lot, coming from the designer of the machine that I had created this hardware for.
You and Waz were a lot alike. I mean, I think Waz shares that kind of love of the design and of the elegant solution purely for its own sake.
Oh, and I can't even tell you. In fact, I met Steve the first time hang gliding in Mexico. Back then the Apple software community was very small and close knit. And there was some publisher down in San Diego, I can't remember their names now, but they invited a bunch of us to go hang gliding, and Waz was, and we all got there and then rented a bus, like a big yellow school bus, to drive across the border down into Ensenada and go to the dunes and do hang gliding. Anyway, you know, Waz, of course, was at this point, you know, famous. The Apple II was famous. And Burl was there, and Hertzfeld.
Yeah.
Andy Hertzfeld. And Burl Smith.
They were working on the Macintosh by then.
Right. And so they were all there, and Waz didn't really know who I was at that point. But I had been really curious about his floppy disk controller.
Yeah.
Because once again, disk controllers. The disk controller for the Apple II was all like, it occupied about 4 square inches of circuit board, and basically it had nothing. on it. I mean, it was like, it was a prom, and it was like, wait a minute, how is this a disk controller?
Yeah.
So I had to know. So I read out the contents of the prom, and what he had done was he had created an incredibly elegant state machine with a prom and a latch such that the clock from the data from the floppy clocked this latch, and so the output from the prom went into the latch, and then the output of that with some other bits of data fed back into the prom. And basically with just those two components, it was a two component disk controller, and they weren't expensive, they were incredibly cheap, but he managed to like solve all the problems, like the synchronization, like arranging to get byte sync when you never knew when you were going to start. And he did that by slipping the phase. Anyway, the point of this is that I really understood it. And so I approached him on the bus, and he just sort of blew me off. It's like, yeah, okay, you know, yes, everyone loves me. I mean, you know, I mean, we know Woz, and he is heart of gold, but he was, you know, after enough of, you know, weenies are like right. telling you how wonderful Woz, you are. Woz. You just, you know, yeah. But I got his attention enough to say, Steve, I have to salute you for the design of the floppy disk controller on the Apple II. Mm. And he said, oh yeah, thanks. I said, the way you slip the phase one bit per cycle in order to lock on, and then suddenly everything changed.
You weren't a weenie anymore, yeah.
He looked at me, yeah. and he listened to me, and he said, you are one of three people in the world. He says, I'm one, and there was like someone else.
Steve,
I don't remember.
Fernandez, probably, yeah.
And
who
you
built it.
Who understand how that works.
Yeah.
And that's all it took. From then on,
nice.
He knew that I was a person who was truly able to appreciate his design genius. And he was absolutely nothing short of a genius. Mm-hmm. I mean, my God, that was a beautiful. I mean, that is his kind of engineering is what I so much miss now, where it's just, oh, throw some more gigabytes at it. You
right.
know, just don't worry about it. Just, oh, look, our GUI is too slow. Oh, well, we'll wait a decade and then it'll seem fast.
Right.
You know, which was what Microsoft did.
That's what happened.
Because it was just
yeah.
horrible crap that they were pumping out and always trying to do more than the processor could because they just weren't writing good code. You know, remember Gem and how fast and efficient it was compared to Windows?
Yeah.
But that didn't matter.
It was the Atari OS.
Anyway, so what Woz's gift was that kind of, I mean, inspired, lean. I mean, my kind of engineering was what Steve did back then.
He still talks about that, how you wanted to squeeze every last chip out of the design if you can.
Because
that's the cost.
Exactly. And that's still, you know, where I'm sitting here looking at a data structure in front of me for the definition of a control that'll be in the Squirrel UI, thinking, well, do I really need a D word? Or can I don't really need four bytes.
Every
I can
byte
do this
counts.
For two.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah,
but
nobody
that's
writes
the point.
That way anymore.
That's the point, is it's like, and see, people will say it doesn't matter, but you look at how tiny my result is. Look at SpinRite that is, you know, smaller than most JPEGs, and it's the Windows code that formats the floppy or installs itself on a USB stick and SpinRite all as one exe. And if you run it in DOS, it becomes SpinRite. If you run it in Windows, it becomes the thing that creates the thing you run in DOS. I mean, you no longer see that. And someone could say, well, yeah, but it doesn't matter that it's 182K. And it's like, well, okay, but it does to me. I mean, the only way I'm going to produce it, if it's like that.
We're talking to Steve Gibson of the Gibson Research Corporation. And we have there's only so much you can do in an hour with Steve. I think we're going to have to do three or four of these shows. But that's always the case with the people we love the most. There's so much to talk about, including his days as a writer, discovering spyware, Tuneful Tilly. There's so much more to talk about. I just threw that one in. That's a painful, a sore subject, Tuneful Tilly. Huh?
Yeah. Well, it was a lost opportunity because it was back in the early days of microcontroller-based games, and I set the classic game of concentration to music, which created a fabulous opportunity. But unfortunately, I did it for somebody else, and it never came to the light of day. Yeah,
it's a lot of
actually,
great technology
like that.
It was
renamed by a brilliant marketing company. Remember the Milton Bradley had Simon, which was those four big buttons, and basically
it
anyway, we renamed Tuneful Tilly to Garfunkel.
The response to Simon. Steve, are you still on the pistachio nut diet? Because I've got some pistachio nuts here for you. How'd that work out?
It did work out, actually. Dramatically lowered my blood cholesterol by eating pistachio nuts.
You know, sometimes people say you are what you eat is not true. But, of course, it's exactly true. You are made up, every bit of you, with the stuff that you eat.
And, yeah, well, what people don't understand is that, well, first of all, cholesterol doesn't matter because our liver produces 80% of the cholesterol that we have in our body. If we eat less, our liver makes more, unless you do something horrible to yourself, like take a statin, which interrupts a metabolic pathway which produces cholesterol in your liver, but also interrupts the same pathway that produces coenzyme Q10, which we have to have. And so
I could tell you one thing you shouldn't eat is trans fats, right? We know that's bad for you.
I completely agree.
High fructose corn syrup, terrible.
Oh, yeah. My God, that's awful.
So, of course, when you go and you get a little hungry later in the day and you want to run over and get a snack and you go to the snack machine, what is it basically? It's a vending machine of high fructose corn syrup mixed with trans fats. Don't do it. Do Nature Box.
One of the best things you could do is just a small handful of almonds.
Yeah, they're great.
Because
now sometimes people go, I just can't eat almonds. So that's why I have here the Chipotle maple almonds. A small handful of those. I'm talking Nature Box. We'll take a little break and talk about Nature Box, then some final questions for Steve Gibson. And this is a sponsor that I really love. I mean, literally love to eat. Instead of getting those bad-for-you snacks, get nutritionist-approved snacks. Never any HFCs, never any trans fats, no artificial sweeteners or flavors or colors. You can select by your dietary needs if you want to go gluten-free or vegan or soy-free or lactose-free or nut-free or non-GMO. Of course, you can put a Nature Box together according to your taste. Select savory, sweet, or spicy. But my suggestion is, on your first box, get an assortment, because you won't believe the South Pacific plantains with sea salt. The smoky barbecue peas. Every time we open a box, there's new stuff. They have hundreds of different snack choices. Roasted kettle corns, the kernels, those are really good. Nature Box. Go to naturebox.com/twit. Get your first box for half off. I warn you, you will be hooked. That its shipping is free in the United States, and you can get a subscription, 3, 6, or 12-month subscription. And if you're in an office, this is the best thing you could do for yourself and your employees. If you're at home, it's the best thing you could do for your kids. Naturebox.com/twit. This is an idea whose time has come. And fortunately, our renewal time has come soon. We're getting new boxes. I love Nature Box. Here, I just had a little handful of almonds. Fabulous. Nature Box.
That sounds great, actually.
It's a really good idea. Steve Gibson is here. If you're tuning in to see Dr. Michio Kaku, he had to reschedule. Next week or the week after, we will have Dr. Kaku on. He's actually, besides being a world-famous physicist, and like you, Steve, a man who can explain to lay people very complicated technical subjects, he's also been doing lately studying the brain. And I think that is an area, as far as I'm concerned, you know, this is kind of one of those areas where a person like you who likes to look at a machine and see how it works might look at the human brain and say, yeah, I would really like to know how that machine works, but man, is that complicated.
There is a book by, I want to say, Jeff Hawkins.
Jeff Hawkins. It's on intelligence. Incredible.
On intelligence. If anyone wants to know, that it is the clearest and most conceptually accurate explanation of how our mind, mm-hmm. how brain creates mind that I have ever read. It is just riveting.
I completely agree. And, you know, it's he was, before he founded a Palm and created graffiti, he was a neuroscientist. So
yes.
It is part of his, you know, training.
And the proof is in the pudding because they wrote software based on the theories and it worked.
Yeah. He's created a new company called Numenta. They're trying to make memory chips that work in the way the brain does with massively parallel processing.
And it's all open source, too. It's really neat stuff.
Isn't that great? Well, Kaku's new book is called The Future of the Mind, The Scientific Quest to Understand, Enhance, and Empower the Mind. I'm very much intrigued by this, and this is all about how, you know, functional MRIs and all the ways we are starting to understand a little bit better how that machine at the top of our bodies works. I cannot wait. It's going to be a great interview. But that is not this week. We are very fortunate to have an old friend, a good friend of not only of Twit, his show Security Now is one of our top-rated shows and has been ever since it started in 2005. It was the second show we ever did on the Twit Network, and boy, that was a great idea when I had that idea.
It sure was. I remember the moment when we were standing between shows in Toronto, and you were sort of had this itch because you worked 1 week a month doing the Call for Help show with Rogers Cable, and of course you had your radio show, but you had all this time, and so you were thinking, huh? How about podcasting? That sort of seems like a future. There's a future there. And I said, what casting?
Who's that? What's that?
You never heard of a podcast? I said, no, Leo, I'm busy.
Well, I think you were a little worried. I know you've said this before that maybe there wouldn't be enough to talk about.
I remember thinking, oh, I hope he doesn't ask me again. You know, it's like, you know, I hope this is just a passing phase and he doesn't bring it up. And it's the best thing I've ever done because it's helped me spread the word about SpinRite, which is valuable to me because that's still the only thing I do to make any money. That's what allows me to be here spending time with you like this is SpinRite.
Yeah. SpinRite 6.1 kind of in process. Let me just look. August, our first Security Now was August 18th, 2005. And you can still get it, by the way, on the twit.tv website if you want to hear. At the time, you thought, we're going to run out of topics.
And we were doing a 30-minute podcast,
I think. It was short.
Yep.
Yeah. We will, I'm just curious. Maybe we could play a little bit of this. It was 18 minutes long.
Wow.
And you thought at the time, you know, there's just not going to be enough material to really fill our time.
And new podcast to the Twit lineup, Security Now with Steve Gibson. This is episode one for August 18th.
Had my voice changed by then?
You all know Steve Gibson. He, of course, appears on Twit.
Well, the theme song has.
We've known him for a long time. He's been a regular on the Screensavers and Call for Help. And, you know, is well-known to computer
users. Kind of sounds like Nick at Night.
I don't know why I was playing that bluesy music. We still hadn't really figured out what Twit was going to be, I think.
SpinRite. Which,
you know, next year we're going to have to celebrate our 10th anniversary.
Still runs rings around it.
Cool.
Can you believe that?
Hard drive. Cool. Diagnostic. Recovery and
that is odd though, all the music going on in the background. It does fade out, but apparently doesn't fade out until really we get going on the show. Is there anything you can't do, Steve, that you just go, no, not gonna do it, not gonna tackle it?
Well, teleportation.
Come on, don't give up yet. It's early days.
Yeah, there are things. Someone the other day, for example, suggested that I write a browser, and I can't. It's certainly the case that the things I can do are size constraint, or
it has to be something one human can do in a reasonable amount of time.
It really has to be. I'm truly not a team player. When I played tennis in high school, and it was singles. It wasn't doubles because I want responsibility for the outcome, and I'm happy to take responsibility.
I will grant you, you're not the best web designer I've ever seen.
True. That's absolutely the case.
But you're not trying to be gorgeous. You're trying to be functional. I remember
you didn't even have menus
for a long time, and you didn't want to do menus because you didn't want to do them with JavaScript.
Correct. We got rid of Mo. I used to have Mo in the old days, which is a strange bald creature that I that I drew. If you look at grc.com in the Wayback Machine.
Really?
It's so painful to look at that homepage, Leo. I was the proud
It actually
anime.
Looks more antiquated than it does today.
Oh, yeah. It's really, really something.
grc.com. We'll go back to January 1st. Oh, that's recent. Let's go backwards. And they haven't kept a lot of really old ones, I guess. 96. Let's go to 96. Here we go. There's one from 1996.
Well, that ought to be it.
There he is, Mo.
There's Mo.
And you loved an animated GIF. There's a man who...
Well, I did those. I did those myself in... I got the big blue box behind me in 3D Studio.
Oh, yeah.
So those were, that was a little project doing the actual 3D modeling of those.
And look, I didn't know you wrote a screensaver for Windows, Chromazone.
Oh, my God. That's how I taught myself to program Windows. Ah. And if there was a masterpiece of Windows programming, that's it. But unfortunately, it only runs in 256 color mode because it used the palette. It used palette animation in order to animate. So it won't still run. But oh boy, it was a real piece of work, Chromazone.
Anyway, grc.com is the place to go to find. Actually, it hasn't changed at all. I'm looking at this is 1998, and it really kind of looks the same. This is basically the 98 design has lived on.
I gave it menus. That was a good thing.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Of course, that was a big project too, because I wasn't going to use scripting. So I had to figure out how CSS could be used to create script-free menus. And my menus have been used by other sites that, I officially gave it away. It's like, I did this once and it's worked now for, I don't know how long ago that was. I did it like 10 years.
There's no JavaScript on your site?
There is script on pay only where it serves a useful purpose. Like in the ultra high entropy random number generator,
right.
The UHEPRNG, there I'm using scripting to show random numbers, flying by on the fly. So
and for your perfect passwords, you probably use a little Java for that.
Yep, scripting is there. Haystacks is the same thing.
Right.
So I'm glad that I script enabled myself for those things, but everything else is pretty much server side rather than client side.
By the way, this is a really good example of. So Steve does one thing that makes him money, and that's SpinRite, and we pay you a little bit each week to do security now. Not enough, I'm sure. In fact, most of that probably goes to pay for the transcripts that you make of the show. Remind me to give him a raise. But all of the other stuff on your site is freely available and of great use. And Perfect Passwords is a really great example. If you need to generate a very long, high-quality random password, there you go.
Oh, and Leo, look at the count. At the top of the page is the number of people a day and the total number...
million passwords generated. That's 13 million people who are a little safer because of you, Steve. Actually, it's a lot more than that.
And I just, I'm bemused by it, but they just trust my randomness. It's like, other people, you could roll a die, but they just rather go and get some from me.
If so you can't trust Steve Gibson's randomness, what can you trust, I ask you? Steve, we are out of time. You've been very generous today. I know you probably have many other things you'd like to be working on right now, but it's such a pleasure to talk to you. We didn't get to the column. The InfoWorld column, which is where I first became aware of you, reading you religiously.
There's a good story about that, too.
There's so much more to talk about. We'll do this. We'll do another one.
Well, whenever you get a cancellation on Triangulation, I'm happy to.
Now, that makes me feel bad. In. That just makes me feel like you were a second choice. You're never the second choice. Well, you were my second choice podcast.
I've had a ball talking with you, my friend.
It's always a pleasure. Steve, I'm thrilled and pleased to be able to count you as a friend. And, boy, this collaboration we've had over the last 9 years has really been great. So thank you.
It's a win-win. Everybody gets to win. I'm really pleased, Leo.
Listen to Steve Gibson's Security Now. It's every we do it Wednesday now, right? 11 a.m.
Tomorrow.
Tuesdays. There you go. 11 a.m. No. We do MacBreak Weekly and we do Security Now. I have no
same,
idea.
Same time as this one tomorrow.
Right.
1 p.m.
1 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Eastern time, 2000 UTC. Security Now, and that's always great. We do cover everything. Very timely show. If there's a security flaw, we will talk about it. If there's an issue in privacy, we will talk about it. Follow Steve on Twitter, because of course he also tweets regularly, and there's a lot of good stuff in there, including some great recommendations for science fiction and TV shows. And
you know, I think that if anything, the Security Now podcast suffers from people thinking they wouldn't find it interesting, or they're not interested in security. But I know from many reactions to people who relate that, they say, you know, I didn't think this it would interest me, but I just like listening to you guys talking. So
yeah,
I would encourage people who think, you know, maybe not for me. It's like, well, you know, give it a listen.
You do what I do. When it gets too geeky, I just tune out. I go,
yeah.
I eat lunch. I relax.
You got a new phone. You got to get that set
play
up.
Play with that. That was very embarrassing. But I did get a new phone, and I needed to have it. At this time, we were doing Security Now in the first thing in the morning, and I needed it for the next show this week at Google. And so I had thought it would be a very quick phone call to activate it on AT&T, and it turned out to be a rather long and involved thing. And having been already deeply into this conversation and been on hold for a long time, when the show ended, I was still talking, and I said, Steve, give me a moment.
Doesn't bother me a bit, my
friend. I didn't want to hang up on the guy. I was almost done.
You were at the front of the line.
I apologize for that. But not Steve's very forgiving. I'll have a good bottle of Cabernet Sauvignon waiting for you next time you come to visit. Steve Gibson, grc.com.
Talk to you tomorrow, my friend.
We do Triangulation now at our new time. And by the way, in 2 weeks, we'll be at a new time. We're going to flip-flop with iPad today. It is now on Mondays, and it's going to stay that way. 1 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Eastern time, 2000 UTC. One more week. It'll either be the woman who designed Centipede, the Atari game, one of the few female game designers in Silicon Valley in the 80s or 70s, maybe even. And then Michio Kaku probably will be at the new time. That's after next week's show. Starting in April, we'll be doing Triangulation at 11 a.m. Pacific. That's 2 p.m. Eastern time. Next week we start?
God,
I thought March 31st.
It starts the first week of April, which includes the last day of March.
So, okay, this is the... Okay, I didn't understand that because it doesn't make any sense. But in fact, it starts next week because it's the first week of April, and apparently next week is the first week of April, even though it ends with, anyway. Next week, 11 a.m., 1800 UTC. Will you join us then? Thank you, Steve. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. We'll see you next time on Triangulation.
Pleasure, Leo.
I felt guilty as soon as he said, yeah, I'm working on it today. I thought, oh, well, I better let him go. I don't want to be the cause of some little bit of string theory.
Why are you talking to us?
Left behind. You got work to do. Go do it.